Come with us on a journey to a place where information is unlocked, knowledge is gained, and the exchange of experiences welcome. This is the Knowledge Exchange, presented by Lakeland Community College.
First, I'd like to thank Nikki Scheid, stand up. She's a Phi Theta Kappa student doing an honors project that's looking at connecting students and the community with the environment. And she contacted me and set this discussion up. This presentation is sustainability in a nutshell. When I was thinking about how to frame the discussion of sustainability, which is a big topic, I deferred to a musing that our president, Dr. Beveridge, who is here with us today, said that he had a instructor in one of his seminars that he took that asked what would be the questions that you would ask if you have a large problem. Would we initially start with a how? How are we going to deal with this? What or why? And the answer was why. We have to first come up with a consensus of why we need to do something, that it is a problem. An elevator talk would be people, planet, and prosperity when you think about sustainability. We look for positive long-term success for all, for humans on the planet. And why would humans not want to live and flourish? So I think that would be the premise for answering the question for why. So if we look at things that are happening right now on the planet and the way humans are embedded in the planet and that these things affect all of us, and we haven't noticed them over the course of time because 150 years ago we were still kind of living close to the Earth, and there weren't quite as many technologies and globalization that brings us a lot closer together, which makes impacts from everything each one of us do, or each country, or each society, have a larger impact on all of us. We do have droughts going on, floods, winds, snow and ice, and they're all effect of climate change. These are all destructive in nature. They're not only destructive from a social perspective that we do see on television, it seems like a lot lately, communities that are severely impacted by these things, and it really disrupts their lives. But we're also economically disrupted. And another aspect is ocean acidification and overfishing of our oceans. This is also an effect of CO2 levels in the air. This is serious, serious stuff. Another aspect, when you look at human society for the last 150 years, would be the consumer aspect of us as people on the planet. And what are the impacts of those things in our environment? They're pretty extensive. It's not just as simple as we can look at the gyres, the garbage patches in the oceans, and we can see a physical thing happening. And you can see a desiccated bird with bits and pieces in the bird. But it's a lot more insidious than that. Pollution is environmental, and it affects human health. So all our goods and services are created with things that we put into the environment. And a lot of these things, like I said, are insidious and we don't see them. Dioxins are a class of chemicals. There's at least 57 of them, and they are carcinogenic. We're finding them in the fat. They sequester in fat and kind of stay there and bioaccumulate. And we see them in polar bears. So they are not even living by us, and yet they have those toxins in them. And we could say that's a canary in the coal mine. Our water is very important to us. We're seeing now that potable sources are becoming more scarce, and that's part of the climate change with less snowpack accumulating and desertification starting to happen in places here in the United States besides globally. That's just a little ha-ha about humans kind of not even thinking about the downstream effects of little things that we do every day. And Nikki had asked, how can each one of us as an individual do something that would impact the larger whole? Because it seems so so far above each individual person. But if we look at what we each do, whether it's recycling or turning lights off or washing our cars, that all flows someplace, and it all either blows or flows someplace. And the things we purchase. I mean, ideally, we would be making and creating things that have a cradle-to-cradle life cycle, where they are either reused, put back into the system, or they can go back into the natural system in the recycling of decomposition of matter and then come back as a plant somewhere down the line. This illustrates the amount of potable water that we have on the planet. The largest dot is that includes everything, the atmosphere, your dog's fur, everything. And as you get down, the next one down includes groundwater, which is not always accessible to us, and the smallest is what's really readily available. So we need to look at water resource as an important thing, and that then ties back into everything else that we do with our products and processes. Another aspect of sustainability is resource wars or ideology wars. Conflict is a societal, environmental, and an economic impact on all of society. We're not just isolated islands, an island unto ourselves. We are a large entity now, a global entity, that our industries have expanded internationally. So anything that goes on in another country, whether it's a resource that we need, like a metal, or there's innumerable resources that we take from other parts of the country, or oil, that's a big one. And if there's conflict in that area, that's going to affect us, and it'll affect our economy, because our stocks and industry are all tied to these different areas of the world. Stress doesn't seem like it would be a big sustainability issue, but it is. The Economist magazine presently, in the next couple days, is going to be having a global symposium on depression, and Kofi Annan, who was the last Secretary General for the United Nations, will be one of the keynote speakers. I remember back in the day in one of my environmental science classes that they said at that time, back in the dinosaur days, that stress was going to be possibly at the top of our global health issues in 20 years. And you know the downsides to stress, everything from just work-related inability to focus and be productive, a productive member of society, to the more serious ramifications of people taking their lives. There's food security, which we all know about, water security, and labor inequity, global human rights and social justice. It's a big part of sustainability that we don't think about very often. So what is sustainability? Historically, we defined it in terms of the environment, but we need to start thinking about it as encompassing social, economic, environmental, and cultural systems, and issues that arise between them. So nothing is an island, everything is connected, and everything impacts everything else. The Brundtland Commission was a consortium of, I want to say, 300 global leaders that got together and wrote a massive draft in 1987 on how we can approach these issues. And this is the most famous quote: to meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So we have to look at how we're living now. Do we like it? And can our future generations actually continue living like this? And this is a global issue. Yes, the United States likes to live like we're living in the wealth that we do, but there's a lot of other parts of the world that aren't living in the same affluence that we are. And how long can this keep going on like this with conflicts? At Lakeland, we're defining sustainability as sustainability can prevail with a global culture that protects and preserves the environment, develops strong and peaceful relationships, while maintaining flourishing and just economies and societies. You need to understand the inextricable relationships between diverse human cultures and natural systems. Understand the interconnections between the economy, society, the environment, and culture. And seek equitable opportunities and distribution of resources. Conserve resources and renew natural systems. So it's not only about conserving. You think of emulating nature, things renew. So we have to start thinking of building societies that not only conserve, but renew so that we can flourish. It looks at the interconnectedness of human beings and nature. It seeks to balance society, the environment, the economy, people, planet, and prosperity. It's gained by building human cultures that make decisions that ensure positive long-term success for all. How can we do it? Is the always the tricky question. But if we look at the planet itself as the framework or the paradigm that's worked for the last, we'll say 2.4 million years through natural research and development, which would be evolution of species and the stochasticity of those species to be able to be resilient and adapt. It's called systems thinking. We think of the planet Earth as a biosphere that's composed of dynamic relationships between all living things and non-living things that interact with each other. Ecosystems are the basis of that. Those are those relationships between the living systems and the environment. And what we need to realize is that we are one of the species on the planet within the large biosphere system. And we're not separate from it. We can't control everything because our, I want to say our locale, as Dr. Beveridge would call it, another scholar would say our Umwelt, our ability to see past our own nose, basically, is limited. A person that I really like is Aldo Leopold. I don't know if any of you have read Sand County Almanac, but he says that the goose would be a pile of feathers if he didn't pay attention to his environment. And we humans on the planet at this point, with the globalization and the lack of connectivity, because our society is so large and we can only see so far, even though we do have our cell phones and our modern connecting devices, that we need to start paying attention to our environment and how the things that we do affect it, or we too will be a pile of feathers. The air, the land, the water, these are called the commons, or ecosystem services. We kind of give it a pragmatic, unemotional term. The soil systems, hydrology, food, jet stream, gulf stream, tectonic, volcanic, they're all systems. They're all parts that affect each other, and you can't pull a part out without it affecting the whole in some way. And within that, embedded within, once again, is our human systems. There are social systems and economic systems. Food, water, sewer, highway, transit, political and geopolitical systems, monetary systems, and school systems. Within the individual, there's the immune system, digestive, neurologic, and endocrine systems. So even within us as individuals, we are a system. And we interact with each other individual and interact in our larger communities, and then with the planet itself. Dynamic relationships that interact with each other, those are the key words. Once again, they're interconnected systems between people and their issues, the planet and environmental issues, and prosperity or economic issues, and where the twains meet. And we can, you know, have a discourse over what those twains are and where they meet. I think the thing to remember is besides dynamic relationships in interconnected systems, is that the planet was doing fine before humans started imposing all their waste and processes and, I guess, anger against each other, conflict, because we are groups. And if we start thinking of ourselves as a global group, we are humans on a planet circling the sun, and we would love for it to continue. Words of resilience, adaptability, and openness. Openness is you in your trajectory, being open to other things that come into your life, being prepared. Use the a metaphor of a seed. A seed doesn't sprout until all the necessary elements are there of heat and water and good soil. And if each one of us individuals are prepared in everything from our own well-being, which, you know, I would like to say, you know, give kudos to fitness and to nutrition and eating properly. And then being a student and paying attention in class, not everything you get in class is from the book. Some of it's from your peers, some of it's from the instructor, and then from the larger milieu at the college. I can't stress enough taking opportunities outside of class to participate with other students in other ways or to come to events like this. I you know, prod my children. I have a 21-year-old and a 23-year-old, and I say, just go to these events because you never know who you're going to meet or what you're going to learn that might be something that you can use in an interview when in the future. And it might be that little seed that you plant in someone else's mind that thinks that you're the one to move ahead. We could once again go through and discuss all the aspects of people, humans, and nature, our separation from nature, and it's something that we really need to consider. The National Parks Department is looking at a program called Healthy Parks, Healthy People. It's tying together with our public health system and Johns Hopkins University and the Mayo Clinic, and they're looking at prescriptive exposure to nature as a way to bring down cortisol levels and increase dopamine and serotonin and just increase your overall health and well-being. We can look at conflicts, gender, race, and religion. Diversity is important, whether it's biodiversity, diversity in humans, or whether it's biodiversity in plants and animals. The human effects on development, once again, we have to look at the planet itself and the human-created impacts, that we have to look at growing requirements for a cleaner and safer process and products that look at life cycle and externality threats. That's your cradle-to-cradle thinking, where you're making products now that will not harm the environment or people. There is a group out of Boston that does green chemistry, and I think it's the wave of the future. We just had a symposium here in Cleveland for the Great Lakes region on that, and I sat at a table with Dow Chemical and Sherwin-Williams and Ford Motors and some other university officials from Harvard University and Delaware. So people are thinking about this, and the more that you're exposed to this, the more you'll participate in that process, and those opportunities will come up. And I really encourage you to take advantage of forward thinking. Human health and environmental health are directly correlated. They're inextricable. Economics is the means of production and consumption of goods and services. The Greek would be to manage the house. And our contemporary Western model is that we look at the bottom line. Can everything lead us to profits? And right now, the shareholder is the god in industry, that shareholder profits are important. There is movement, though, when they look at raw material and labor, life cycle analysis, externalities, those downstream consequences of processes that aren't added into the bottom line. So it's economics is a big monetary numerical science that can account for, look down the road and account for costs. And historically, we're not counting in the costs of human health. And we're starting to see that it is a big factor, and there should be a responsibility for those impacts. Corporate social responsibility is trying to address that, and the triple bottom line. Case Western Reserve University has the Fowler Center for Sustainable Values in their master's program, and they teach the triple bottom line to their master's students in business. They were invited at the time that Kofi Annan was Secretary General at the UN. They were invited to the UN for a three-day appreciative inquiry to brainstorm with 500 global business entities on sustainability and corporate social responsibility. Aesthetics, even though it doesn't seem as like it's part of sustainability, it reflects and interprets humans and culture and nature. It connects humanity together. It dialogues about individual and community global issues and experiences, art, music, poetry, prose, film, architecture, you can go on and on, how humans through the arts have expressed the human condition, oftentimes in ways that we can't do, maybe communicating with each other. But if I showed you the picture of, well, those people look pretty comfortable on those, and if I tried to explain that to you, you might not get it as much as seeing a picture of them sitting there just really soaking up the sun on those neat little things. Pablo Picasso did this painting, Guernica. It illustrates the destructiveness of war. It's fairly famous painting, but it shows not only humans, but animals in the environment around that are affected. And this carries down generation to generation. Art maintains itself as a means of communication. Hiroshige was one of my favorite black print painters from Japan. And they also, in their culture, have an affinity to nature. It's just kind of ingrained in their culture. And so it helps inform us and shares beauty of nature with us. This photojournalistic picture of the Afghan girl with green eyes, I don't know if any of you have seen it, it's pretty famous. I found her, the picture of her today, and my women friends here would probably be surprised. I'm sure the young men maybe that are sympathetic, but the woman is a bit older and she looks pretty haggard and pretty sad. Her life situation hasn't improved any in Afghanistan. This is ordinary people doing extraordinary things. This is from the earthquake that happened at the, anybody tell me? This will be my question. At the World Series in 1989 in Oakland, California. But to capture that moment, you know, a photograph, you know, is worth 1,000 words. And to see that people actually work together under duress. So I would like to think that there's hope for humans on the planet if we come to the consensus that there are problems and that we would like to address them. What does this mean for us? We have to develop a way of thinking that frames the way we make our decisions that consider people, planet, and prosperity. I'm going to just give you this little quick view of industrial agriculture. They frame things differently now than we used to. We have pests in the environment because we do monocultures, which really is against, back to ecosystems. Ecosystems don't grow all one plant in all one place. And when you do something like that, you're naturally going to have the pest that loves that food, that plant, in abundance. So our agricultural system frames them as pests, but what they don't think about, and this is just an example, is that the aphid in this case will go on an oak leaf and bite it and get its own little food, but it creates honeydew on that leaf. And that's the bee's food when the bee doesn't, it has his lean times and is looking for a blossom that might not be there. But unfortunately and inadvertently, our commercial agriculture doesn't look at the synergies. Once again, our umwelt, our own trajectory is limited oftentimes. And I think that humans on the planet are limited by what we can know. We like to think we know everything and that if we control that aphid and we get rid of him, that we'll have this great crop. But what we inadvertently do is we've killed the bee. And now this is in a crisis situation. that neonicotinoids are being seen as one of the culprits, probably besides many other toxins that are in the environment. But it's an endocrine disruptor, and they can't find their way back to their hives. At Lakeland, we do sustainability using the framing of people, plant, and prosperity. We apply the principles of sustainability. One of the big things that we started was doing energy efficiency. So we look at systems efficiencies and then advanced technologies. We're open to new opportunities, so we're always in every aspect of the college, all department levels. We're looking at ways to reorganize, to bring the best to the community and the student population. And we measure and assess for continual improvement. That's something, you know, that you don't think about very much. It's like you do something and then you have to see if it's working or not. And if it's not, part of that stochastic nature of the equilibrium in nature is it does the same thing. If it's not working, that animal doesn't live, and you move on to something else that does. And we emulate that in our measurement and assessment. We belong to ASHE, which is the Association for the Advancement of Sustainability in Higher Education, and they have a program for assessment and for improvement called the STARS program, and it's a really extensive list of things that we can do to improve the college. And this is, member colleges are over 800. So this is an open source project. We can go to, any student can go to this site with your Lakeland Web address, and you can get on here. And you can go to any university that's a member, from small ones like Lakeland, Stark State, Harvard, Emory, Duke, any of the big ones, and see what they've been doing in those areas, and it helps us to benchmark ourselves against another school and kind of get us going. But we also can learn from each other and have some ideas on what to do. It's broken down into education and research, which is the curriculum, co-curriculum, education and research, operations, which is everything that you see in the buildings, the climate, the dining, energy, grounds, purchasing, transportation, human resources, et cetera. Innovations, if we come up with any good ideas. And planning and administration. We have a strong diversity and equity group here at the college, and affordability, access, and other planning and administration areas. A big organizing certifying body is LEED, which is Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. It is third party, so we just don't say that we did well. We have to meet certain standards to do well. We did get certified silver in the University Center and the C Building, and we've framed how we do things. So we've, you know, gone from industrial agriculture frame, you know, keeping the aphid out of the picture, to including things like indoor environment, health, and wellness. So that would be your social aspects. And we procure things, or a good percentage of things, from within 500 miles. So we use goods and services that were from the locale, so it helped the local community. You preserve resources. It saves money in the long run, which is good for the bottom line for both the college and the local community and for students. We have reduced our CO2 footprint. Our reductions in natural gas have been 48%, in electric 38%, and in water 37%. And this all came out of an energy resolution that the college adopted and was championed by our senior VP Mike Mayer, who's
our
right
president.
Here, and our president. Yes, I have your letter to ASHE on my board that backs up the work that we've been doing. This was one of the things that I saw when I came to Lakeland. I saw this on NPR before I knew that Lakeland was doing well, because somehow we just don't know past our own Umveld, even though Lakeland's here and I'm in Newbury. It's too far away. But NPR had Lakeland and Colorado University and a couple other good universities on. And we sat at the table right next to these people, and we're best in class. And it's something really to be proud of. There are other universities and townships that are modeling after what we've done. So it's quite an accomplishment. And it's someplace that we can build from. This is the greenhouse gas emissions inventory. Annually, we do this to see what our carbon footprint is, not only carbon, but the other greenhouse gases. You can see the biggest pink thing there, except your colors are different than my colors, is student commuting. So if we take student commuting out of the picture, because we are a community college and we do account for you and your petrol that you burn, if we take that out of the picture, we're at about 50% improvement. So from 2004 until now, we've improved by 50% on the amount of greenhouse gases that we're putting out into the environment. We also have a fairly extensive recycling program. These are all the waste stream areas that we have collected data for. So we really try. We have a paper and cardboard recycling, a single stream recycling, which is available to everybody on campus, and hope that you avail yourself of that to participate in us doing better. We have a surplus program that we, instead of throwing things out, we put it out online and people can buy it, which is kind of nice for people, and it's good for us. We recycle our pallets, we recycle our metal, our oil from the breaker's kitchen, our light bulbs, our tires, and plant material. This comes out to a total of 47% that we've diverted from the landfill, which is nothing to sneeze at. We've done a waste audit, Lisa Lewins and I and Joe Kiliancha. Wake up, Joe. Did a waste audit last spring with students, and we found after we took bags from that would have gone into the trash dumpster or the compactor, that 34% of the stuff in those bags was recyclable. And that's pretty much the campus community, that we could be keeping that stuff from going into our trash and compactors.
That's an area of opportunity?
This is an area of opportunity. That measuring and assessing allows us to see that we can be doing better. Another thing that the waste audit did is offer a co-curricular activity. One of these places that I encourage you whenever you hear about anything to take advantage of. It showed our program of recycling and how it synergizes with classroom information, that it has to do with business and cradle to cradle and physical sciences, making things that don't end up in the trash. Health and wellness, we had students from that area because eventually those particles that are disintegrating are turning into chemicals in the air and water, the dioxins that eventually we take in and probably are causing some of our major problems. What other areas? The health area, the physical sciences, I think that, you know, that pretty much covers it. But it just showed that through all the disciplines, there was something that, there was a takeaway for each one of those disciplines. We have also installed the first green roof in the county. It's right above us, third floor. It's nice, it's doing well. We have white roofs that reflect the light, so it decreases the amount of cooling that we need to do in the summertime. And this, I've been told, is about a 37% reduction, just reflecting that heat away. We have stormwater runoff systems. We use native plants and integrated pest management. The Holden University Center is a great place to see some native prairie species. Go over there in the springtime, and then in the summer, and then in the fall, and you can see the succession planting. They're really beautiful, and they're worth taking note of. We do Energy Star purchasing now. It's part of our process. So when we are acting as a consumer, we are thinking about where our money's going and how it can be most wisely spent. We have a green kiosk that's in the E building. It's a monitor, looks just like a monitor on the wall, and it's a touch screen. You can go on that and see the history of our energy process and what we did to get to the point we are. I mean, there's pictures of backhoes out there putting in pipes and how these systems became integrated. The Moreland Mansion and Gardens is a great asset to this campus. It ties in history, which is part of our sense of place. The Garden Club has maintained the gardens over there, which are historic gardens. And we recently put in this path going from the mansion itself out to those gardens. I encourage you to go over there anytime that you need to cool down or to be brought up. If you were going to have an exam, take a walk over there. The walk will do you really good. And being in an environment where there's a pool with fountains going, it's very ethereal, to say the least. You can sit on benches and just be quiet over there. It's really a wonderful place. We do have a website, a sustainability website, which can be gotten to by about the commitment to excellence, and then sustainability is right off that. Or we'll have this QR code on some of our information, and here's the web address also. Once again, for curriculum aspect, we can weave these concepts of sustainability transdisciplinarily to show that there is a connection and a dynamic relationship between society, the environment, and the economy. Co-curricular events that we've done recently are the Phi Theta Kappa piece that we're doing this minute. I encourage any students in, if you're writing papers or if you're in a club, to see how you can weave together and connect things. The Center for International Education has just hosted a sustainability presentation, and our director is here, Eric Usach. The Center for Geographic Information Services and Dr. Usach put on the ghost debris recently, and that was the Ocean Defenders Alliance came from California. He was actually raised here, and then his trajectory took him out to California to do good and do well, cleaning up the debris from ocean harvesting. There are nets and traps, boats, you name it. They're all floating around under the water and catching animals inadvertently. What's the figure, Eric? 300,000?
350,000 dolphins and whales
a year are killed just by this sunken debris. And it's just counterintuitive. And this was one individual that took it upon himself with a little boat and some friends and some diving equipment to go out and start cleaning it up. And he has progressed over the years by keeping at it to have a larger boat. And they're still looking at funding. It would be great if we as a nation and we as a voting public would say, yeah, this is something that we want to do with our tax money, is maybe to keep our oceans clean and keep some of the other species on the planet from dying for no good reason. But coming to events like this that we offer help bring these issues to light, because we can't all be expected to know everything that's going on. The Green Group and the Hunger Banquet that we just had with Lisa Lewins was a fantastic opportunity to see the cross, the connecting between the food system itself and our social systems, poverty and hunger. Our young TLC, the children, came to that also. So we connected generations, which I think is really important, both for us to have the children there, but also for the children to see those people that I'm sure they're sitting there calling you the big kids, you know? I want to be like the big kids are. And we hope that they too move through the system and grow and expand. The Women's Center did the movie Girl Rising, which was a great film on education for women. I'm sure that the girl, the picture, the Afghan girl with the green eyes, if she had that opportunity, things might change. Once again, we do well together, people, planet, prosperity. That's sustainability in a nutshell. It's all how you frame it.